until you begin to obey. Just as a car is static until the gear is engaged. In the school of faith, obedience is the last course. If you are not prepared to obey, don't go for the subject of faith. This is why the scripture recognizes in Romans chapter 16 verse 26 what we call the obedience of faith. Obedience of faith. The final thing faith will require from you is your obedience. But now it's made manifest and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. If you hate to obey, then get ready for faith failure. In the word of God's servant, our Father in the house, obedience may be costly, but the end result is priceless. Obedience may be costly, but the end result is priceless. Deuteronomy 28, verses 1 to 13. It's a long but powerful list of what will result in your life simply for obeying God. And it shall come to pass, from verse 1, it shall come to pass. Something always comes to pass when you obey. You cannot obey and end on the floor. It shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently to the voice of the Lord your God, to observe, that is, get the details, and to do. That's the summary word for obedience. All his commandments, which I commanded this day, that the Lord thy God will set you on high above all. Do all, he will set you high above all. Do little, he will set you above little. Do much, he will set you above much. Do all. He will set you above all the ends of the heart. And without prayer, verse 2, all these blessings shall come on you and overtake you. Before you recover from one, another falls you down. If thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord your God, those who obey more pray less. Find out, most people who pray and pray and pray and pray and pray, the level of obedience, low. If you obey low, you have to pray high. Obedience is cure to prayer struggles. Obedience may be costly, but the end result is priceless. 1 Samuel chapter 15 verse 22. Saul thought he had impressed God with what he did. God says, shut up. To obey is better than sacrifice of prayer, sacrifice of going around, and to hearken than the fat of rams. John 2:5. Whatsoever he tells you to do, do it and leave it to him. Do what he tells you to do and leave it to him. Leave it to him. Leave it to the doer. If there is anything God requires from you and I, is to obey. He said, this is the final commandment of the Lord, to obey him. Obedience is the finality of all commandments of God. Obey him today, and you will not struggle tomorrow. Now, obedience is the beginning of miracles and signs. As we saw in John chapter 2, verse 5, whatever he tells you to do, do it. And in verse 11, the word of God tells us, this beginning of miracles did Jesus in Cana of Galilee. How did he do it? They obeyed him. Miracles begins in your life when you obey God and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. The beginning of God's miracle in your life is prompted by your obedience to his word. Faith comes by hearing the word, but miracles are born by obeying the word. That's why you can be so loaded with faith. If you don't obey the word of faith, it never translates into a miracle. The linkage between the word of faith and the miracles of faith is obedience. You don't know what is in obedience until you begin to obey. I heard that word again from God's servant. You don't know what is in obedience until you begin to obey. And that means blessings await our obedience. Please be informed. There is no cheap or easy obedience. Obedience will place a demand on you that will require your choice to comply or not. If it is not costly, it will never be rewarding. As a matter of fact, the cost of obedience will determine the level of the rewards you assess. So those who want easy way of getting it are limiting their rewards from God. All adventures of faith demands obedience for them to be accomplished. As a matter of fact, obedience is the ultimate test in the school of faith. Genesis 22:1. And the Lord came to test Abraham. It came to pass after these things. So it's a continuous thing. After these things. Before then, Abraham has been tested severally. After these things, that God did tempt Abraham. In the school of obedience, you faced test every day. There is no graduation in the school of obedience. The Lord came to Abraham to test him. Satan is aware of these things happening in our lives. That is why he tempts us to disobey God while God is testing us to bless us. Satan is the tempter, God is the tester. From today, you'll be passing the test of obedience. Amen. Somebody say loud, amen. Amen. Now, example of Abraham, quickly, because he's the father of faith. Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 to 3. The Lord said to Abraham, I will do these things in your life. Get out of your country, move out from among your kindred, out of your father's house to the land which I will show you. And the summary of it, I will make you great, I'll make you a blessing. And in verse 4, and Abraham departed. Now, in the school of obedience, you have to depart from something to enter into another thing. And Abraham departed. Chapter 17, from verses 9 to 14. We can get time to read that by ourselves later. God told him, I'm about to establish this covenant, but you have to circumcise yourself. At that old age, think of different side effects of cutting the flesh. We understand from medicine that the older you become, the more fragile your body becomes. A child can break his leg, 2-year-old child, and 2 weeks is running back again. But when somebody at 70 breaks his leg, he's forever broken. Except by divine intervention. They get to a time, they say, hey, don't carry out surgery on him because he's dangerous. So at that age, Abraham didn't mind the side effect, the danger that was in the circumcision. Verses 22 to 26, the same day, he went into action. This circumcision, in order to obey God. And of course, in Genesis chapter 22, we saw how it happened. Verses 1 to 3, the Lord said to him, take your son, thy only son Isaac, to a mountain which I will show you. Go and sacrifice him there. And we saw what happened after he did that. Verses 16 to 18, God gave him a generational blessing. Beginning from today, God is going to release generational blessing on someone here. Yeah. If you are that person, make that amen louder. Yeah. Now, quickly, therefore, what is obedience? Very simple. Obedience simply means compliance with scriptural commands. Whatever he tells you to do, do it. God doesn't seek our opinion, he gives us command. The Bible faith is a world of ifs and then. Ifs and then. It shall come to pass if then shall you be the head and not the tail. You'll be above only and not beneath. Then shall the Lord open his treasures from heaven and give you rain in his due season. Look at it very well. There is no mention if you obey and pray. Answers to prayer is contained in obedience. What is obedience? Number two, strict adherence to instructions. That is, becoming subject to the laws of God. Being subject to the laws of God. Daniel was a clear description of these in chapter 6, verse 5. When they were looking for how to get Daniel, somebody said, we shall not find any occasion against this Daniel, except we find it against him concerning the law of his God. He strictly adhere to the laws of God. The ones who strictly adhere to the laws of God are the ones that God will bless extremely. If you want extreme blessing, strictly adhere to whatever he commands you to do. What is obedience? Obedience is the proof of godly fear. Until God's instruction moves you, you cannot move God. Strict adherence to instruction, proof of godly fear. Genesis 22:12. After Abraham had gone forth to sacrifice his son, lay not your hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. For now I know that thou fearest me. If you don't obey God, you don't fear God. Now I know that you fear me. That you did not withhold back your son, your only son. Now I know you fear me. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 7. Through faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not yet seen as yet, moved with fear, and prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by which he condemned the world and became heir of righteousness, which is by faith. I pray that this morning, the fear of God to obey you will overwhelm your heart. Amen. Somebody say louder, amen. Amen. What is obedience? Number four. Obedience is full expression of faith in God. If you are not obeying God, you are not believing God. Full expression of faith. After the complaint of Peter to Jesus, he concluded Luke 5:5, nevertheless at your word, I believe. It looks contrary to what is happening, but I believe your word. I will let down my net. Obedience is full expression of faith in God. It's important, however, for us to understand at this point that obedience, being a spiritual virtue, requires the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. There are many people who want to obey God. They really want to obey God. And Satan stands on their way to obey God by the spirit of disobedience. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 1 tells us about the spirit of obedience. And Ezekiel chapter 36 verses 26 to 27 tells us about the spirit of obedience and how much we need that. Satan is aware that if you obey God, your story will change. So he will raise up opposition. He will give you reasons why you should not obey God. That's why we need the empowerment of the spirit of obedience. And today, by the unction that backs up this commission and the power at work in Shiloh, I release that spirit upon you right now. That spirit is heavily upon the servant. And I decree, because we belong to the same family, the same spirit at work in him to obey God comes upon you right now. Make that amen louder right now. Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 26 and 27. A new heart. What heart? A heart of obedience. Also will I give you. And a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh, a heart of obedience. And I'll put my spirit within you, which will cause you to walk in my way. That spirit walks in people to obey God. And he shall keep my judgment. It will become easy for you to keep my judgment and to do them. The spirit of obedience. The spirit of obedience. How many of us are receiving that spirit right now? Pray in the Holy Ghost right now. In a few seconds, let that spirit come upon you right now. As it is working in his servant, as promised by God, I receive that spirit right now. Begin to bind the spirit of disobedience. As you are praying now, I know you can remember instances when you disobeyed God. Bind that spirit. I will no longer disobey God. I will no longer disobey God. I receive fresh baptism right now to obey God in all that he commands me to do. Thank you, Jesus. So shall it be. What are the outcomes of obedience, especially looking at the story and the life of Abraham? The blessing of obedience covers both now and the future. Life in the present and life to come. Every time Abraham obeyed God, something new happened to him. Genesis chapter 13, verse 2. Remember, in chapter 12, he departed. And the following chapter, Abraham had become very rich in cattle, and in silver, and in gold. You can't obey God and be left in emptiness. Abraham had become rich in silver, in cattle, and in gold. We have had so many testimonies of how people obeyed God and things happened beyond their widest imagination. You will be the next testifier. I say you will be the next testifier. You will be the next testifier. In the precious name of Jesus. In chapter 22, as soon as he attempted to make the sacrifice, the Lord said, "Now I know you fear me." From verses 16 to 18. And he began to reel out blessings upon him that would transcend his lifetime. "By myself have I sworn, said the Lord, for because thou hast done this thing and hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, that in blessing I will bless you. In multiplying, I will multiply you as the seed as the sand of the heaven. I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven, and as the sand which is upon the seashore, and thy seed shall possess the gates of your enemy. And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice. Because thou hast obeyed my voice. Everyone who has received that new heart to obey God, very shortly, your blessings will become uncountable. Yeah. I say your blessings will become uncountable. Yeah. Number two outcome of obedience in this life is authority over opposing forces. Authority over opposing forces. When you obey God, everything around you obeys you. Your health obeys you. Money obeys you. Circumstances obey you. Territories obey you. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 6. When you obey God, all your struggles with elements comes to an end. And having in readiness to revenge all disobedience when your own obedience is fulfilled. So our drive is to fulfill our obedience. Once your obedience is fulfilled, every other thing obeys you. From today, everything around you will obey you. Yeah. I say everything around you will obey you. Yeah. In the precious name of Jesus. Abraham enjoyed blessing on earth here, and hereafter in heaven a glorious place was given to him. Luke chapter 16 from verses 23 to 26. We saw that how Abraham was given a bosom in heaven. He became a landlord even in heaven simply for obeying God. And because we are seed of Abraham, we're entitled to blessing hereafter. That is to say, the blessing of obedience transcends beyond the heart, waiting for you out there in heaven. When we get there, you will find your blessings of for obedience awaiting you. Amen. Say loud amen to that. Amen. Now, for our obedience to be rewardable, note the following place. Number one, obedience must be prompt. Promptness is very vital. Now, everything about God comes in times and season. Seek the Lord while you may be found. Call upon him while he is near. There is a time God expects you to respond. God is patient, but he will never delay. God is patient, but he will never delay. He gives us ample time to quickly respond. Because for everything under the sun, there is a time and there is a season. Promptness. To make our obedience rewardable, we must be prompt. And again, we can learn the lesson of promptness from Abraham. Genesis chapter 22. Chapter 12, verse 4, and Abraham departed. Chapter 17, 22 to 26, the same day. Chapter 22, verse 3, he rose up early in the morning, he rose up to go to offer the sacrifice of his son. Promptness. If the devil cannot stop you from hearing God's instruction, he wants to delay your obedience. I've learned from God's servant, our father, once the Lord speaks to him early in the morning, he must kick off. No delay. Because once you delay, the fire goes down. As I'm speaking right now, a number of us may be reflecting and be remembering how that through delay, you miss many opportunities. Now, I command that the spirit of delay in responding to God's instruction shall be broken off your life. I decree right now that the zeal of the Lord will so overwhelm you to be obeying God promptly.
Number two, for obedience to be rewardable, it has to be absolute. Absolute. Full. If you notice Abraham, the Lord told him, take your son for sacrifice. He did not only take the son, he took the wood. Because he could get there and tell God, I forgot the wood. He took the knife. Full. From chapter 22, verses 6 to 11. We saw how he did that. Even the son asked him, here is the wood. Here is the knife. Where is the sacrifice? And he looked at him. He said, well, the Lord will provide, and it could be you. Amen. The Lord will provide, but it could be you. Absolute. And that was what earned him respect from God. Now, Jesus told Peter in Luke 5:4, cast your nets, plural. Let down your nets for a draught. Maybe the Lord has told you to do something and you are rationalizing it in your head. Will this thing work? If I give this thing, will it work? Sometimes ago when we were in Rajoba, there was a story of a brother who brought sacrifice. Very painful sacrifice. The Lord told him, give the television in your house. And according to him, that was the only treasure they have in the house. Children have no other thing in the house to play with but to watch the television. And as they were watching it, he went on there straight and unplugged it. No permission from them. He said as he took it and carried it on his head, he began to weep. Painful. And from that moment, everything turned in his life. Full obedience. There are some people God tells them to give their car and say, well, I think I have to give some money. You obeyed God, but not in full. Cast your nets. And you know what Peter said in verse 5? I've told all night, caught nothing, but at your word, I will cast the net. The net. Jesus said nets. Peter cast net. And in verse 6, all he caught broke that net. If he provided all the nets will have been full. Obedience must be absolute. The undoing of King Saul was not obeying absolutely. 1 Samuel chapter 15, from verses 1 to 3. 3 specifically, the Lord said, destroy them. Don't spare any. Very specific, definite instruction. Don't spare the king. Don't spare even their cattle. The Amalekites. Destroy them utterly. That's what I want. But he didn't carry that out. Samuel the prophet came and said, why did he disobey God? Were you not told to destroy everything? He said, we felt we should spare some. The people advised me to spare some. That was how he lost his throne. Many people have lost out. Not because they didn't obey God, but they didn't obey him absolutely. Do you know what happened to Moses? Why he couldn't see the promised land? The Lord told him, speak to the rock. And he went there and struck the rock. And God said, because you have despised me in the eyes of the people, you shall not see the promised land. 3 times he prayed. God said, forget it. May none of us here do what will not make God hear our prayers. Number 3, to make our obedience rewardable, do it willingly. Willingly, eagerly. Isaiah chapter 1 verse 19. If you be willing and obedient, you shall eat the fruit of the land. 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 12. If there be forced, a willing mind. 1 Corinthians chapter 9 verse 17. if I do this thing willingly, then I have my reward. Anything God tells you to do that you are not willing to do, forget it. As a matter of fact, you may even get cursed for it. But that will never happen to any of us here. Number four, for our obedience to be rewardable, do it cheerfully in worship, not as a burden. Cheerfully in worship. Cheerfully in worship. Genesis 22:5. Here was a man going to sacrifice his only son that he waited for 25 years. And he said, "Abide here with the house, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship." We are going to worship. We are going to worship. Killing his son was to worship God. Obey God, delight somebody. Not as a burden. That is another way to guarantee the reward that is contained in it. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. God loves a cheerful giver. Finally, what are the hindrances to obedience? And this is very crucial. Number one, people factor. People factor. Beware who you talk to about what God has spoken to you. There are those who will discourage you and tell you, don't try it. If Abraham had made consultation, they would have taken him to psychiatric hospital for losing his mind. You prayed for 25 years to get something, and that thing has grown for 16 years, and you are going to sacrifice him. Something is wrong with your head. If the wife knew, Abraham would not have woken up. She would have slaughtered him while sleeping. People factor. People factor. When this ministry started, God's servant has told us this story several times. After the commissioning in September 1983, he said the Lord told him not to go away from Ilorin. Some people gathered together in a meeting. I said, "Shall we pray for Brother David? I think he's confused." He told us God spoke to him to go to Jos. And here he has said again, God didn't speak to him. Let's pray for him. People factor. God told you to give a sacrifice and you are discussing with people, they won't let you give it. God told you to take a step in a particular direction and you heard them very clearly. If you discuss with them, they won't let you take it. That was the undoing of Saul. The people. 1 Samuel chapter 13, verses 7 and 8. The people. Samuel told him, "Wait for me to come to do the sacrifice." He said, "I saw the people trembling. I feared the people. The people were following trembling. They were intimidating him." Courage to obey God as he speaks to you, receive it right now. Three times he mentioned the people. Verses 14 to 11 to 14. The people. Chapter 15, verse 24. The people. He was under people pressure. That's why we need to pray that in following God, God should deliver you from people. People's view, people's intimidation, people's counsel, people's castigation. Receive freedom from people's factor in obeying God. And number two, finally, entrance to obedience is ego, pride. Based on knowledge and experience, as it happened to Peter. Peter said, "I've been fishing here for a long time. Oh, you don't catch fish anyhow like that." The ego and experience of many people have robbed them of obeying God's word. When God's servant was going to ministry, according to this story, an elderly brother in the faith asked him, "Brother David, by the way you are going to ministry, what is the savings you have? Because as far as he's concerned, you can't go into ministry without savings." And you know his answer, as usual? He said, "Even if I have anything, I will spend it before I leave so that I can focus on God." Don't use your knowledge and experience to destroy God's instruction. Be delivered from people. Be delivered from experience. Be delivered from your expertise that you have. That is how to ensure that no hindrance stands on your way in obeying God. By the word you have received right now, I know the spirit of obedience has come heavily upon you. From today, the next thing God tells you to do, you have courage to do it. Please rise to your feet with me and pray that prayer right now. Father, I receive the baptism of the spirit of obedience. Empower me with the spirit of obedience. Give me a heart to obey you. 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 Thank you, Lord Jesus. Blessed be your name in Jesus' precious name. Please get seated and give Jesus a big hand.
Shiloh 2019. You've been blessed by that great, blessed message. Put your hands together for the Lord. Give him some praise. Give him some praise. Hallelujah. In this hour of visitation, it's Shiloh announcement time. Are you excited about that? Please pay attention to the following. Number one, you are all welcome to Shiloh 2019 in Jesus' name. Expect definite visitations this morning. Number two, specialized sessions continue today. And this include one, healing and deliverance class. Two, fathers and mothers of nation class. Three, marital breakthrough class. Four, breaking generational curses class. Five, business and career turnaround class. Six.